about it in a few minutes. But remember these things. I just wanted to mention about if you did apply for the course assistant job, it is, first of all, still open, so you still can. But we won't actually look at the applications until, like, you know, sometime this month. So just don't feel like you've been skipped over or anything already, because I literally haven't looked at them at all. So just keep in mind the timeline is basically over the course of the summer. Any questions? Yeah. Yes. Oh, no. Never mind. I lied. I thought we did, but we don't. So any other questions? There is a notebook, though. Okay. All right. So talking about residuals again. Let me just make my screen a little bigger so I can see what I'm talking about. All right. So the residual is basically the error in the regression estimate. You know, think like a remainder is a kind of a more common word than residual for the same thing. And then there's three different ways that you can calculate it or think about it. And those are kind of important. So keep those in mind. But what's really cool about the plot, the scatter plot of the residuals, is that it should look like an unassociated blob for linear relations. So if it's just, you know, a blob that's circular, that probably means that you have a decent linear regression. And if you see a pattern in the dots, then it's likely that you are using a linear regression and shouldn't be. And it's a good way to check and see if the linear regression was a good idea. And as I already said, curves, trends, changes in spread, outliers, other patterns, those are all indicators that maybe this isn't the right fit. So properties of residuals. So it should have like a zero average, and then a zero correlation with X, and a zero correlation with definitive values. And if it's not, then maybe there's something else going on. Often it just means you actually have a straight up like mistake. So one of the ways, it kind of can test your model, but it also kind of tests whether or not you did things correctly. So there's the kind of rough overview. We'll come back to the tricks. So this is a different browser. Just the easy way. So if you can't see that, let me know. I can make it bigger. Is that good enough? All right. So this is just a bunch of helper functions, getting our favorite Galton table. And where's my mouse? Completely gone today. Oh, sorry. I have the wrong thing open. So the first thing is pretty easy, which is, see if I can find my mouse again, is if we take that average of the residuals here, and so we just have a little function up there that calculates the residuals based on the single table, and if we take that average, we just round it because we know it's going to be close to zero. It may not actually calculate exactly zero, but what we're looking for is for it to be zero. So that tells us that we did it correctly, right? And that, you know, basically our math is right. So then we can kind of move on and do our predictions by adding. And so what we're doing in the values here is the same thing. We're just doing a linear regression. We figured out what the line that we think gives a good prediction for this data set is. And so we calculate all sort of y values based on the line in addition to our values. So that's just giving us that table. Myself. And then I can see that if I take the correlation of the heights, right, with the midterm and the residual, I'm able because we expect it to be zero. And the same is true if we do it with the fitted values. So in other words, our y values that are calculated. And that's going to zero, so therefore we know that the calculation is correct. So these are just kind of cross-checking techniques. And it, you know, these tools, like these mechanisms for cross-checking, will work on any data set. So it doesn't matter what it is you're doing it with. If they're not coming out to be zeros, essentially it means you're doing something wrong. All right. And then, I actually showed the graph, but it's this one. So, you know, we keep coming back to this same example, just because it's a good one. And so we have our mid pair, and these are all our zero values, and then this yellow dotted line is calculated values based on the line that we decided was the correct one for the regression. Yeah. You would have to write it. The only things that you'll have will be what comes standard. All right. We'll talk more about the final exam later, though. So if you have more questions about the exam, hold off unless it's like, you know, is this on the exam kind of question. Okay, so if we then plot the residuals, we'll see down here, right, we have a nice looking So, but what we can also get to is the standard deviation of the fitted values, the fraction of the standard deviation of the observed values of y. So, in other words, if you divide the standard deviation of y, or sorry, the standard deviation of the fitted values by the standard deviation of y, we'll get the correlation. But in accordance with the other direction, if we put the correlation is, then we multiply it out by the standard deviation of y. Non-zero effort, right? So with this one calculation, we can tell us if we're going to get a decent result or not. And then, we also can see that the standard deviation of the residuals, right? So it's kind of all getting to the same answer. Okay? But there's multiple mathematical ways to get to get a sense of what's the quality of the result if we use the inputs we've chosen. So, and then just to show the actual calculations. So we can see this is the residuals with the actual heights, right? So this is with the observed data, and we see that we have a standard deviation of 11.5, which is not great, right? That means that the spread is pretty big. This is 11.5 inches. So we know that, you know, if we go 3 out, right, that's 33 and change difference in height, okay, which is like 2 and change feet. So that's a pretty big difference in height, right? Like, it means they're ranging from 4 foot tall to 6 foot tall, right? So, you know, when we're talking about that, what's the point of prediction? Okay, so. But we know if we take that linear regression, it's a better, like, it's a better estimate than the actual observed. It can also combine because we're not trying to incorporate all of the heights of the shoulder. We're just trying to incorporate the length of regression. So you can see our accuracy, if we calculate that, will be within, you know, 1.3, say the one-standard deviation will be 1.3 inches. Right? So in other words, you know, we're talking about 96% or something, which is about 3 standard deviations out. So that means you know, range of 3 inches to 3 inches. That's actually pretty good. Because we can say, you know, if the parent height is 5'10", then we know that they're going to be between 6'1 and 5'7", right? Which is, that's pretty good. Certainly a lot better than 5'10" and the range being 3'10" and, you know, 7'10". So it's just kind of just, these are kind of various techniques to tell us about the quality of the data that we're looking at. And then, just kind of using the correlation kind of the same way, just create a sense of the testing of the residuals, right? So we know that the standard deviation of the residuals will be about 3.3, right? So that means it's kind of how big that blob is. And remember, we want the smaller the blob, the better the quality of our predictions. All right. So some tricks based on this that are here. So now these are actually a little bit, these are based a little bit more on error than they are on the true residuals, because they kind of are when you're making your estimate, you haven't like figured out what your line is exactly, then what you see is that if the average of the errors is plus or minus zero, so in other words, it's not zero, then that means that you should shift the line by the difference between zero and the average. For example, which we talked about last time, and I thought it was pretty obvious, is if the average is 10, then that means we shift it. We need to shift the whole line. So if we have a line like this, we need to shift the whole line up by 10 units, whatever the units are. So if it was negative, right, we'd have to shift it down by 10 units, and that should get us an average of errors that are zero. Does that make sense? Assuming that the things are also common, which they look like we're looking. But then if we have a correlation, there's plus or minus, so it's off zero. Then it tells us that we raise or lower the slope. So if the correlation with x is greater than zero, then we need to raise the slope. And if it's less than zero, we need to lower the slope. And then, you know, we kind of keep reiterating this, that the arcs and curves stuff, linear regression is probably not right. And then the quality of predictions, this is what I said already, is related to the standard deviation size. The smaller the standard deviation of the residuals, the better.
Okay, or the higher we, or the better our predictions are. So that's kind of the residuals. Basically, they're mostly for error checking, right? They're checking for straight computational errors, and then they're also checking for, okay, did the line that you built, and whatever mechanism you used to build that line, how accurate is it, and what can you do to it to make it more accurate? So it's kind of giving you a bunch of hints about how to solve to get the best predictive line, or if a predictive line is just a bad idea altogether. And we saw lots of examples of when it's a bad idea. You know, the dugongs were incorrect. The women's heights and weights was also incorrect. You know, in other words, they were not linear regressions. Yeah. So it's technically the average error, not the average residual. The average residuals will always come out to be zero. But if it's the average error, basically the shift in direction follows positive versus negative. So if it's positive, it means it goes up. And if it's negative, it means it goes down. Up, like the whole line goes up, not the slope.
Okay, does that make sense? All right. So we're going to move on to another topic, which is
another kind of prediction, okay? So what we've been doing is we've been kind of saying, okay, I have point A, right? And I want to figure out point, you know, B, right? Or let's say I have point X and I have point, and I want to figure out point Y. There's another kind of problem we want to solve, which is called classification. And so this is when we guess the value of an attribute, and obviously it's incomplete information, as otherwise these would not be very useful at all. But so what we might want to do is predict an outcome for an individual, we find others who are like that individual, and the outcomes you know, and then use those outcomes as a basis for your prediction. That sounds a lot like doing like a linear except we can actually do the same kind of thing simple, hopefully, demo. I have to find my mouse so I can see what I'm looking at. So, in this case, so one of the things that we've started to see in recent, well, actually, let me back up a little bit. Out of that. All right, and so yeah, that's right. Okay. Wait, where's, sorry, I can't find the field I'm looking for. Yeah, so what we did was, or not we, but what somebody did, was we determined that there's two different classes of these patients, okay? And the way we determined that is we decided that they were in this class or the other class based on all of these values, okay? So whether they're in class 0 or class 1 is kind of the outcome that we're looking for. Now, why do you why the data is really useful and why we're not done yet, because what we want to look at is future cases. So what we can see, though, if we look at the data, is we can see that if you're in class 1, right, then you have a white blood cell count that's kind of like all over the place. But if you're in class 0, you have a white also look at other relevant data and say, look, if we look at heat pump and testing for the glucose, we also see that the cluster is about zero. And so we have high hemoglobin, but low glucose, that also seems to be clustered together. Right? Whereas we don't see that same nice relationship between third class blood and seems to be a little bit more over the place. So, as it says here, right, so what we want to do is figure out the class of someone without having looked at every single data on it. Right? So what we can do is say, hey, can we start to figure out, put some nearest neighbors around it, right? So let me kind of skip a little bit. So, you know, we were looking at the hemoglobin and the glucose, right? So we can look at those two elements, and we can start to make a classifier based on the hemoglobin and glucose data sets, or data elements, features, whatever you call. And we can now start to try to classify that individual into one of those categories based on those neighbors. They're in the right space to be class zero or class one. Really, the way this data set seems to work is really it's either in class one, right? I think. It's in class zero, sorry. It's in class zero or it's kind of elsewhere, right? So class zero means it's fitting in these constraints or it's just kind of somewhere else. Almost like a circle around this region, and if we see a dot that falls in that region, we can have a pretty good guess that it's going to be of class zero. Does that make sense? So when we were talking about the mid-parent height in child, we were doing something similar, but we were just kind of taking a vertical slice, right? This is kind of the same idea, except that it's doing it a little bit nicer in that we're getting a little bit more bounding region. And so we are essentially doing the same technique. Right? We're kind of saying, hey, it's kind of like these other ones that are nearby, so we can make a prediction about what we think it is. All right? So, using another example, we have a whole bunch of banknotes. We get these characterizations, and then we classify them in either class zero or class one. And in this data set, we have what looks like 762 of class zero and then 610 of class one. So we kind of do the same thing, and we look at, are there regions where we can make some predictions, basically, and we start to think about what we're going to circle around the various classes. Using that data element. So, and I would actually almost argue this one's even worse, where we have, this is kind of using the wavelet skew as well as entropy. And then, so what we're doing here is like, now we can actually go into other dimensions, right? Is that we don't necessarily need to be limited to just two dimensions. Okay. So we can then say, okay, dimensions or 10 dimensions or whatever to actually put something in the same bucket. All right, but we're just covering this at a very high level. So we'll go back to the pictures. And so just to kind of round it out, what we do is we take the attributes of an example, right? So in other words, we figure out, we take a set of data that we know is correct, essentially. And then we build our own bounding boxes around it. And the reason it's hard to say bounding box or whatever is because it could be n-dimensional space and probably a box and, you know, all those things. But you get the idea, right? Like, there's a lot of something where these things are falling. Population, all right, and we get some samples and labels, and then we separate it into two pieces. One we call our training set, and then one we call our test set. Does anybody know why we split this? Or what it means to split it? So it's kind of here on the slide a little bit. So, and a little bit more formally, in this case, our classifier is a nearest neighbor classifier, okay? And so we just kind of figure out, like I said, kind of like a bounding region based on the neighbors in this space, whether it's, you know, two-dimensional space or three-dimensional space or whatever, and use basically the actual calculations, right, to say, is it within that box? And that's how we figure out whether that sample is in the prediction space. So, you know, whether it's in class 0 or class 1. To figure out how to make this work, we use the training set, and then to figure out how well it works, we use the test set. Makes sense? And then, one last thing I was going to talk about before we talk about the final is. Wasn't obvious, right? We need to be able to figure out the distance between the elements, right? And so what we do to do that is we essentially use the factor of the theorem to say, okay, what's the distance? Because this value and this value are so much easier to find than this value. And so we can calculate it. But we usually know what the, like, the direction. That's what we mean by, you know, how close is one thing to another, is we calculate the distance using essentially Pythagorean's theorem. Okay? Except you can kind of keep scaling this up into multiple dimensions. All right? Any questions? All right, and so what I want to make clear is that even when you have, so when you have a bunch of different features that all feed into whether or not something is in class 0 or class 1, what that means is you're essentially creating an n-dimensional person is, you know, 6 foot tall, and this person has, you know, is right-handed, right? Now we've just done a three-dimensional space, but it's really just that we have a whole bunch of features, and so as a result, each feature becomes a dimension on trying to get that box to put the classification in. Does that make sense? Okay. All right, so, like I said, I just wanted to briefly cover that because I think classifiers are really interesting, and there's a whole mess more of them. Has anybody here heard of a neural network? So a neural network is a classifier, for example. And they're really interesting because no one, a lot of the time with neural networks, no one's actually quite sure how they work, which is, I think, really neat in software. All right, so for the final, so I've talked about some of this already. So there's two parts. There's a written component, which will be mostly, and we're going to talk about kind of what's going to slot into which part in a second. But there's a written component that is closed book, no notes, no whatever. And this should be stuff that I expect that you know off the top of your head. Obviously, you'll have to study to be able to know off the top of your head. But it's the kind of thing that you should just have in the back of your mind. The Jupyter Notebook component is, you know, a couple big caveats, right? Make sure that you've got the SCC in an instance. Make sure that you have a laptop. The graph, but if I said what type of graph do you use to solve this problem, that would be a very good example. And then just kind of from a scope perspective, it does cover the whole semester, but really the focus of it is on since midterm. Okay, but you can't really do this class, like I can't not ask you a question that involves something you learned in the third lecture, right? You know, if I ask you a question, it's going to have a table in it. All right, so I think you saw this already. Let me just jump to the next slide. So it's a little harder to read, but so graphs, so I kind of put each of these things, the thing that's after the hyphen, right? Is like the classification of that. Also need to know how to make them. Okay. Sampling, that's a method. So this is, you should know all the steps into getting a sample of data out of, you know, a set of data. Okay. Bootstrapping, that's a multi-step method, right? So you should, like, what I would recommend is that you have kind of memorized how to do a bootstrap, but then the activity of it is more like, you know, like the mechanics is what you would do in the notebook side, so that part would be open, so you can kind of go look that up, or have helper questions, or whatever. That's the bootstrapping side. Confidence interval, that's more like the confidence side, so what is a confidence interval? Why are they happening? What do they mean? Here are the trick questions I'm gonna put in there, right? Which, that, like confidence interval, that would be the place where I would definitely So I had one more thing, which I talked about a little bit before. So I talked about kind of these example questions. You might have done this homework. Which one is the So these are the kinds of questions that you would expect in the notebook, okay? So the notebook will be like a few like programming questions at the beginning kind of, and then almost like, you know, a lab or a mini project or a homework. If you have one error, it won't cascade into all the rest of it. You know what I mean? But the things that you should know, okay, and this is where open book tests are tricky, okay, in that they're, because I know that you have access to the entire internet, it's going to be hard enough that you should be able to answer these two questions out of your head. And go and like look up your notes or you know or look on the internet or whatever. Like how to implement that. But deciding between nearest neighbor and bootstrapping should be something you know. Otherwise you may run out of time. Does that make sense? This is one of the most deceptive things about open book exams. My class, any class, they are usually structured that if you don't know the basics, you don't want to because it will probably land